Hi, I'm Paul. In this video, I'd like to talk to you about slow practice, double thirds, as we find them in Chopin's Etude Op.25 No. 6, and demonstrate a number of preparatory exercises I hope you'll find useful whether you intend to play this study now or at a later date. For those interested, I have tutorials already posted on this etude in my tutorial playlist. I'll begin by running through 25.6 twice in succession at more or less the same speed overall, but with the contrasting tempo changes we're familiar with. There are many varied ways to add breaths and transitions between changes in tempo, so both recordings will inevitably have subtle differences in this respect. I'll run through one more time with a more consistent tempo overall, so the double third trills, for example, will inevitably seem slightly slower than in the previous two versions. have you come across the pianist, composer and writer Abram Chasens? If not, I've linked below to one of his piano compositions you might like, available on YouTube at the time of making this video, called A Shanghai Tragedy, from his set of three Chinese pieces. Chasens writes about overhearing Rachmaninoff practicing Chopin's 25.6 arriving for a visit at Rachmaninoff's house in Beverly Hills. This account features in Chasens' book published in 1967, Speaking of Pianists, linked below. Rachmaninoff was a dedicated and driven perfectionist. He worked incessantly with infinite patience. Once I had an appointment to spend an afternoon with him in Hollywood. Arriving at the designated hour of 12, I heard an occasional piano sound as I approached the cottage. I stood outside the door, unable to believe my ears. Rachmaninoff was practicing Chopin's Etude in thirds, but at such a snail's pace that it took me a while to recognise it, because so much time elapsed between one finger stroke and the next. Fascinated, I clocked this remarkable exhibition. 20 seconds per bar was his pace for almost an hour, while I waited riveted to the spot, quite unable to ring the bell. Perhaps this way of developing and maintaining an unerring mechanism accounted for his bitter sarcasm towards colleagues who practiced their programmes once over lightly between concerts. A bar of 20 seconds makes the duration of each semiquaver 48 BPM. So let's listen to what this slow tempo practice sounds like. If double third scales are new to you and you're curious about them, you can prepare for them by becoming fluent with the single note chromatic scale played with fingers 3, 4, 5, like this. We need to eventually play chromatic 3, 4, 5 as confidently as with the usual 1, 2, 3 fingering. So the earlier you begin this scale in your piano studies, the better. And of course, it's never too late to start. The reason it's important to practice chromatic 3, 4, 5 is that the top note of the double third scale is the leading note played with 3, 4, 5. The bottom note of the double third scale follows along and is played with fingers 1 and 2. If you practice chromatic 3, 4, 5, your double third scales will sound even and, importantly, fingers less likely to freeze up mid-run. Thank you. It's not practical to make many demonstrations of slow practice in a video such as this, so I'll suggest the following exercises be played at 48 BPM and the tempo gradually increased over time. But this tempo of 48 BPM be returned to on occasion. In addition to slow legato work with even dynamics, we can add to that the full range of dynamic gradations from loud to quiet and quiet to loud. In addition to developing the touch associated with legato, we superimpose the touch associated with contrasted dynamics. It may sound strange to say, but I don't know of a piano work quite as fun and physically engaging to play as Opus 25 No. 6. I hope you too will feel encouraged to play double third scales. Good luck with them, and thanks for watching.